Very good morning once again, and welcome back to The Big Issue. My name is Mubarak Mugabo. Now, we've been having a lot of issues and the stories that are making headlines. Yesterday, we saw a story that came out from the New Vision, which was showing over 100 youth who were, jailed, and their whereabouts were not known. But SIU Chireka yesterday released them, and they are now back to their families. And there has been also talk to do with a conversation on transition from the Minister for Justice and Constitutional Affairs, but emphasizing the need to engage into the national dialogue. Everybody's talking about dialogue, but many of the people conceive it differently. What do we mean by the national dialogue? Who should participate? When should it take place? Who qualifies to represent Ugandan interests in this conversation? We just want to understand it and give you the perspective that you may need to know around this whole conversation. Joining me to discuss that are three distinguished gentlemen. Frank Rusa is the executive director of the Interparty of the IPOD, executive secretary of IPOD, but also working with the Netherlands Institute for Democracy.
Multi-party
democracy, I beg your pardon, excuse me. Stephen Muchitare is a member of parliament for Bulisa County, former member of parliament for Bulisa County, and Moses Matovu, the spokesperson of the National Economic Empowerment Dialogue, a political party that was recently formed. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining me this morning, but Honorable Stephen will be joining us later in the show, rather from his home area. Let me start with you, Rusa, before I come to Moses. First of all, we have had this conversation, especially coming in from Norbert Mao, the Minister for Justice and Constitutional Affairs. Although there is a lot of debate whether actually he was sent by the president to come out and start this whole conversation. But let's first actually explain to our viewers, what do we mean by national dialogue? What entails it? And who is supposed to be participating in this whole conversation?
Good morning, Mubarak, and thank you for having me in Urban TV. It's always nice to be here. Good morning to my fellow panelists, Mr. Matovu, and online, Honorable Mukitale, and fellow Ugandans out there who are listening to us and watching this program. I think, for starters, let us first understand what a dialogue is. A dialogue is a conversation between one or more individuals for a purpose of arriving at a consensus on a way forward. There are different kinds of dialogues that take place in life, but when we talk about a national dialogue, we are talking about a national conversation. Now, of course, there have been several dialogues that have happened along the way. There's a dialogue that has been going on between political parties under the IPOD framework, that is political parties with representation in parliament, say, let us meet and converse and discuss issues pertaining to our lives as politicians, but also as a country. That is a political conversation in IPOD. Then there is a dialogue that has been requested for a wider conversation between Ugandan citizens beyond just the political parties, to bring more people on board to discuss wide-ranging issues that have disturbed our country since the time of independence, or even before independence. Over the years, there have been certain questions that have been left hanging or swept under the carpet that keep popping up from time to time and cause tensions in our country. So some people were saying, especially the religious leaders, they led a conversation with the elders of Uganda and several other interest groups, and said, I think it is time to have a national conversation about a range of issues, about national values, about the way the economy is going, about the land question in Uganda, about historical issues like the Buganda question, about electoral politics, about corruption, and many other things. Now, when they brought up this conversation, it was about 2 years ago, about 2 to 3 years ago, is when they said, we need to have a national dialogue. And I said, who is going to lead this national dialogue? Then they said, why don't we have the religious leaders under IRCU working together with the Elders Forum, the Elders of Uganda, eminent people, senior people, respected people who are the Elders of Uganda, together with the government of Uganda to jointly oversee this national dialogue. A communique to that effect was signed, I think it was on the 18th of December 2018, when the government said, okay, let us work together to form this national dialogue. And then I was part of the steering committee of that national dialogue process. Unfortunately, because elections were coming up in 2021 and also issues of funding, and that did not take place. Now, so people have always been asking, when is it going to pick up again? When is it starting again? We're not seeing it. But while that is going on, there's also been other dialogues in IPOD and other areas. But just to get to your point, why a national dialogue and why do we need this conversation?
Before I get to that, I just want to actually, Moses, to come in here. You are coming from a political party, but mostly advocating for economic rights of the people. Where do you come in this whole conversation, and how do you perceive national dialogue, and why do we need it in the first place?
First of all, good morning to you.
Good morning,
my colleague.
Good morning.
Good morning to the viewers. A dialogue was needed like some 20 years back. It's not something I would say we needed it. I mean, we just need it now. I think before we even talk of a dialogue, there are some basics we need to diagonize. One, who brought the cause of the dialogue now we are speaking about? What went wrong? By who? If you're going to have a dialogue, do we have those people maybe who messed up and they're ready to confess and they say, let us bury our hatchets, then we move on? Do we have them? No. When you're going to dialogue, first of all, I think 2011, there was some kind of agitation for a dialogue. You remember the
arising the, from the political
the walk to work,
yes,
stuff,
walk
and
to work, yes.
Yeah, it was like we need to dialogue because a lot of things had gone astray,
triggered by the violence that
yes.
we saw in the election.
Yes,
but from given the explanation that given by Frank, seems like many people just perceive that from the politics of the
yes,
country.
Yes,
but it seems like it's narrow to
yes.
You know,
when they talk of
the
a national dialogue. It shouldn't be a piecemeal dialogue as our president has been doing it. He dialogues with UPC, he gets a few of them, dialogues with FDC, he goes to the churches, picks a few of them, and that's the kind of dialogue. And actually, I call it a monologue that he imposes on them, not a dialogue, really. So that's why I was saying we need to go back and diagonize what went wrong. Go back to 1962, the formation of Uganda, the 15, should I call them provinces, that came together to form the so-called Uganda for a common interest. In 1994, during the Constitutional Review Commission, it was suggested, actually a majority of Ugandans opted for a federalism, I think 65% of them. Instead, they were given something different. Now, if you're talking about a dialogue, where do we stem? Where should the genesis be for dialoguing? Should we look at the recent problems of Uganda? Do we stem them back from the 1962, as he said, or before? Really. So I think a dialogue is important. But you dialogue with a party that is ready to listen.
You dialogue with an equal. But also you have to engage into dialogue with people
yes.
who are willing to
yes.
sit on the same table. I want now to bring back Frank before I go to Stephen. There is an issue of what should be dialogue, what should be actually talked about, and what should entail dialogue. You're raising a lot of issues, economics, politics, culture, and values of the country. But this looks like a very wide scope that can take ages, 50 years talking about these issues. What should be the priority and what should be topping the agenda of this conversation?
That's a good question. But let me just explain that. For a dialogue to be taken seriously, as the brother has just raised. It is important that the people who are going to participate in it have faith that whoever is coming to participate has goodwill to see the results implemented, that it's not just a show, or you're not trying to fool around some people, or trick them, or hoodwink them, that there's some genuine commitment to it. Number two, the people going to be involved in the dialogue should participate in shaping the agenda of the dialogue. It should be inclusive, because the issues you find dear in Buganda may not be the issues that the people in the north find dear. It won't be the issues of Kasese. Yes. Everybody has got their pressing issues. And you cannot determine what is more important than the other. Yes. Everybody has to participate. Now, I agree that we cannot dialogue forever, but there are those key big things, what I call the big things on the table. That is the reason why in the national dialogue process that was led by the Interreligious Council and the Elders Forum and other actors, they came up with 8 points. And those 8 points were arrived at after national consultations. They consulted widely in all the regions of Uganda and zeroed down on 8 key things and said we need a political consensus, we need a consensus on issues which have come from the past, we need to, there are certain questions they raised. But I agree that in any dialogue of any type, it is first important to deal with the elephant in the room. There are those urgent issues. Now,
For example, the president who has been here for so many years.
The president being here, for example, he has argued.
And the issue has always been that, Frank, when you are trying to engage these stakeholders, you don't want to talk about that subject.
No, I'm willing to talk about I am going to talk about it right now. You see, now the problem with that issue is this. Whenever we talk about, we used to have a problem with the Forum for Democratic Change in trying to shape the agenda for the dialogue. Because the Forum for Democratic Change would say, if there's going to be a dialogue, it should be about one issue, alternation of power. When does Museveni leave? That is what FDC keeps saying.
Which is a very particular
Yeah, but NRM says that the issue of how Museveni leaves power is settled in the Constitution. That there is a constitutional process, we go to elections every 5 years, so unless you're talking about the quality of elections, that's another issue. But for me, I'm of the view that why do we have a dialogue, yet we have got all these electoral processes and parliamentary processes and everything? It's because we are saying that democracy does not mean the tyranny of the majority. Democracy means that the majority can have their day, but even the minority should be listened to.
And should also have a day.
Yes, so now dialogue creates a space whereby, even though you don't have the numbers in parliament, if you feel your issue is so big, let us have another space to resolve these issues. Because sometimes elections alone do not resolve issues. We have seen elections end in some countries and countries slide into total chaos, even after an election has happened. So we are saying that besides the elections, there could be other processes to deal with the sticker issues that continue to undermine our unity as a country. But what Matov said, Ndugu Matov here, which I think is very important, he emphasized the need for goodwill. You know, this country, people are so suspicious of each other. The moment you put anything on the table, me saw it in iPod. when I was facilitating iPod dialogue processes, one day the president of Forum for Democratic Change told me, this dialogue is not serious, and let us seven commit to it, then we shall come.
Yes.
If Museveni doesn't commit to it, we are not going to the dialogue. But listen to this. The day President Museveni said, I am coming to the dialogue, FDC ran away. Said, why is he coming? This is the trick.
So
the problem that we are having is that our country lacks trust in each other, but also trust in the process.
But, you know,
so let's bring that trust.
I want to bring it up to Moses. Moses, the big elephant in the room is the politics of this country.
Yes, of course.
You must agree. But also the big elephant in the politics of our country is the Yoweri Museveni.
Yes.
As the president of this country. Are the people who are engaged into this conversation or into, you know, trying to preside over this dialogue and beginning this conversation, do they have reservations on the president and they fear to talk about him?
So
that's why
many.
Dialogue
so,
goes wrong.
So many reservations. Unfortunately, let me say it, the man is not trusted at all by other political players. Actually, even NRM, they don't trust him. Including his son, he does not trust him. If he trusted him,
that's quite
yes. No, 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 no.
I mean,
yes, if you trusted him, he would be maybe waiting for the right time.
One thing
now,
maybe what Frank was talking about, trust, all
no, I'm talking about trust in my own view, not in his view. In my own view, look at a man.
And what you're saying is that the opposition leaders are trusted, and Yoweri Museveni is trusted
somehow. Now look at a man.
Somehow, but
who
not,
came?
But not the. Who? They are not also saying.
No, look at a man who was a socialist. Okay, because of money, he drastically changes to capitalism. I think you know that background, and he knows. Look at a man in 1995. They made a constitution, okay, 1995. They never let that constitution to test. I mean, to work. When it came to term limit, actually, anything he suspects that is blocking his consolidation and the longevity, consolidation of power, he will definitely work against that. Now, he does not even trust a document or an agreement that he himself participated in making. That is the constitution of Uganda, 1995.
He did not breach the constitution. There were spaces.
Definitely. I'm alive to that. Okay? Now, when it comes to the age limit, okay? These are the guys who made that constitution. There was a purpose. Why such things were put there? He never trusted even the constitution. He removes it. Now, how do you tell me, if he cannot respect a constitution, how do you tell me he's going to respect this mere document done by you and me? And I mean, binding is that document?
I think, to be fair to the president, so he appointed an opposition leader, an opposition political party leader, as a minister for justice and constitutional affairs. Isn't that enough goodwill to have this conversation?
We have that topic on the menu, or...
It's about national dialogue.
Now,
and I think that's
what I began by talking of a piecemeal dialogue. We are talking about dialogue with all Ugandans. I talked about the 15, I called them provinces, because for us in need, we call them provinces, okay? That formed the so-called Uganda. These regions have different issues, different interests, as he said. Now, who are you dialoguing with? You dialogue with somebody, you promise somebody a ministerial post or two ministerial posts, and I mean, then you have dialogued with the whole country. Have you dialogued with people in Karamoja who are dying now, yet seated on a lot of wealth, on minerals? Is that kind of dialogue? So, a meaningful dialogue, I think, to me, should cater for all the interests of the different parties, the different regions that make up Uganda. Two, we should be ready to live up to the outcomes of the dialogue. If we talk about equitable distribution or sharing of resources, can we live up to that? You'll find that apparently, actually today, Uganda is being narrowed to being managed by a small village. It's being narrowed. Yesterday I was reading Monitor? They gave us the names, the shortlisted names, the contenders of the governorship of the Bank of Uganda. Really, when you look at that...
But there's no contention there.
No, there is a contention. Do you know why many Ugandans are boiling? Did you see what happened in Naduli's whatever funeral?
That was hooliganism, certainly. Uh-huh. We cannot...
But what do you think is the cause of that?
We need
Did you see what happened when Afande?
Just a minute. Need a national dialogue to tell people not to
just a minute
engage in two.
Just a minute. Did you see what happened when Afande Tumwine died, and so many others, including Tumusime? Did you see? There are so many other people have died, and there is no such a thing. Why do you think so? So there is something boiling. People cannot speak. Now, They brought this, is it Computer Misuse or something, Act? Again, to zip up people, all right? So, now they no longer have a way of airing out their grudges. So the thing is, they're bailing. So that is why we say we need to sit. We need to discuss these issues. Now, but when you see a country...
Can we have a conversation and a national dialogue that is based on values without involving the person or present Yoweri Museveni?
It cannot be. Because the head of state. Just imagine, because you say...
But he has created now, a space for you say, to talk.
Yes, talking what? Now, I come here, for example, if we are talking about Ebola, now I give some good suggestions, maybe suggestions that have not been maybe implemented. Will they implement? No. But I'm giving an example.
Yes.
You come up, somebody comes up, a very fine economist, you give suggestions, blah, 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 blah. Nothing is done. They have their own script. There is no way you can dialogue now.
I think we
without him,
there's a big point of freedom miss, really.
Yes. Mm.
And I don't want Ugandans to miss this point. Any dialogue, you see, for us now, we are Ugandans and we are here because God has allowed us to be here in this time period. Mm. There will be Uganda after all of us have gone.
Yes.
There was a Uganda before we came. Mm. A dialogue, a national dialogue of any type should focus on Uganda, not
yes.
on the individuals involved.
Exactly.
So now if we get lost in Museveni, we'll get lost in the, we should ask ourselves, what kind of Uganda do we want to leave for our children? That should be the kind of question, because I agree that Museveni is a big factor because he's been present for a very long time.
Mm.
I agree that one is, but we should not be so taken up because he's an individual like any other. He will go away like we shall all go.
Mm.
But we should ask ourselves, what has gone wrong to bring us to this boiling point? He has raised the issue of what happened at Jakana Naduli's funeral and at the Afande Tumwine's funeral and other
ETC.
Yeah, that is not. Nobody should even be happy to see such things. This is terrible. It is terrible if our country can reach those levels.
Mm.
And I agree that that is a symptom of a bigger problem.
Definitely.
Now, however, what we should be asking before we throw away the whole process is, what kind of dialogue will address the root causes of those problems? What kind of process will be seen to be fair, inclusive, transparent, and effective? That means, how do we assemble that vehicle?
Because like
we have to work together
to assemble
that vehicle.
We have been having this whole conversation.
We have to have some trust.
The biggest problem has always been the agenda.
Yes.
And the
agenda setting process.
Exactly. And the agenda certainly wants to top the politics.
Because the politicians think that politics is the main issue to discuss, which is not a bad thing.
How about having, what is wrong with having a national dialogue, and we first say, let's first ignore the issues to do with politics, because that looks to be a little much more complex issue, and we deal with economic issues and the distribution of resources as top of the agenda, and we see whether
let me give you information on that, because the national dialogue process has something on that.
Mm.
In the national dialogue process, that question was asked.
Mm.
Because you see, the people in the national dialogue process were saying, politics is too serious to be left to politicians alone.
Mm.
So it said, let's have a double track.
Yes.
There will be a track for political consensus and a track for these other issues. So I said, the politicians will sit and argue the political issues and develop a consensus. But while that one is going on, at the same time, we should deal with issues of the economy. We should deal with issues of corruption.
Moses, we are going to come back
to
the agenda.
It was a wide thing.
And who should really lead this whole campaign.
Yeah.
But we are now joined by Honorable Stephen Muchitale. He's a former member of parliament for Bulisa County. He's passionate about the dialogue processes. Honorable Muchitale, very good morning and welcome to Rush Hour.
Good morning, Urban TV. Nice to join you from Hoima.
Honorable, let's go straight to the issues that we are discussing. There's been a conversation about national dialogue, and I'm having here colleagues talking about what should be discussed and what should be on the agenda of a national dialogue if we were to have one. First of all, is it the right time to have a national dialogue? And how do you perceive this national dialogue?
Thank you so much, Urban TV and fellow panelists, Frank Russo and the gentleman from the Economic Transformation. The national dialogue for this country is long overdue. This country has been war between itself without the victor choosing the vanquished. We missed this opportunity when we came from Tanzania in 79. We missed this opportunity as NRA when we came from the Bush in 1986. We missed this opportunity when we were making the constitution, when we unfortunately constitutionalized my NRM party to be a system and blocked others for 20 years. We missed this opportunity of a national dialogue in 2005, when political parties were being brought from freezer for 20 years after being castrated, and we expected them to compete with my armed NRM funded by the state. And I'm just giving this background to show that we have lost a lot of time. And you can see where we are today. We need to build a new consensus. We need to agree as a country whether we want to democratize into a civilian rule or want to continue increasingly military taking over, being in charge of the state of affairs. We need participation and inclusion. In the last 3 months, you have seen what is in Kenya.
Honorable, how do you say
Kenya went into a national dialogue?
How do you say that we are under military rule and the state is controlling everything when you have
I am saying you have all
institutions of government and are functioning?
I am also a political scientist. So when I say we are increasingly militarizing, the civil space is reducing, not only for political parties, but even for the civil society. That space is increasingly not there. So I am saying, for the sake of our grandchildren, the Bazukulu we talk so much about, can we deliberately and consciously, like Kenya did after having a problem in 2007, you've seen what's happened in Kenya. You saw an election in Kenya in August. Is that what you have in Uganda? You have just seen the vetting of cabinet by the whole public. Is that what is happening in Uganda? So, when we start enjoying to watch Kenyans as East Africans more than what happens in our election in Uganda, it is something which shows you that we have a deficit. We have a deficit in our democratization agenda. Yes, democratization is a process, but the trend must be abundantly clear that political parties, as institutions which are allowed to do interest articulation, to recruit people, can go nationwide and recruit people, that parties can have ideology. The constitution I'm having here talks about looking at things that national character. You have seen in Kenya, people applying for jobs, they compete, they are vetted openly by parliament when everybody is seeing. You are seeing the devolution in Kenya. Article 178 of the Constitution of Uganda talks about regional governments. Where are regional governments? So we are even operating unconstitutionally. Uganda at independence is a formation of the 15 regions, which 15 regions in Article 178 of the Constitution are supposed to be regional governments, and their cultural institutions are supposed to be titular heads. The budget is largely still in Kampala. No wonder that's why everybody has to beg. So the issue of the powers of the president, the issues of the military, but you can even see, we cannot hide our hands in the sand when you can see the radicalization. Honorable, the consensus is not there. People are so divided, people are so polarized. So we must deliberately and consciously work towards building a new consensus of this country through truth and reconciliation, through constitutional review commission, and through national dialogue.
You've been in parliament for quite some time, and actually some of these issues you're raising were happening under your watch. But also, there has been a conversation on accusing you politicians of trying to own this whole conversation and trying to reduce the national dialogue to one man, that's President Yoweri Museveni. Should the national dialogue, can't we have a dialogue and a conversation without the personality of the president, and we continue to have this?
I have advocated for national dialogue for the last 15 years in parliament. In 2006, while joining parliament, I said it was a mistake for the NRM party, the NRM to declare itself a party when it is a parastatal, which is formed by blood, which is funded by government, which has the military wing, and expected to compete with political parties, which were not there anyway. So that alone was a mistake. From day one, that was my position, and we should have a dialogue at that time, divested this parastatal called NRM, and then we missed out. So we would rather have had 5 years of a national dialogue, of a truth and reconciliation, of amnesty, so that we start from as a clean plate. Now, you have seen 15 years after declaring multi-party, there is no multi-party. There is no functioning multi-party. Otherwise, the debate of succession and transition would be in DP, in UPC, in NRM party, in NRM sector. It is not there. You can now hear the Mo's project. You are here for the first family fighting.
How are those Mo's projects and all of that related to the national dialogue? I mean, Honorable Muchitali, I just don't understand why you reduce a national conversation to individuals. Can't we have a conversation, for example, on the direction of the economy of this country, a conversation on how we should maintain our values other than discussing the politics? And maybe the politics comes later. What would be wrong with that? Or you're just wanting to discuss politics because that's where your interests are?
I agree with you that this is a national debate, and I speak a national debate. But I also don't want you to be so hypothetical, to be so utopian, to imagine he's the commander-in-chief, Yoweri Kaguta Museveni, who has been the head of the commander-in-chief for 37 years, who has been in charge of all secrets of who becomes rich, who becomes poor, who can die, and who can, for 37 years, a commander-in-chief in charge of foreign policy, a commander-in-chief, the chief executive, the fountain of honor, and you just wish him off. I think that would be so utopian, and I don't want to belong there. We are saying it is very important that whereas we want to have that national agenda, the government of the day, you cannot wish it off. It is very important that we in NRM, I am an NRM 311, but I am worried the direction we are taking. We are taking this country in the wrong direction. So it's important we in ourselves have an introspect so that we can say it is now time to say, yes, for 37 years we had intentions at NRM. Like Nyerere did. Nyerere said, yes, everything I did for Tanzania was in good interest, but there are things which have not worked out. So can we have an introspect as NRM for the sake of Uganda, for the sake of grandchildren, say there are things which are not going well, and this is where we need to bring in a national dialogue. Is a win-win situation.
It's a win-win situation. I want to guide you. I want
Honorable Muchitali. Is about accepting what has gone wrong.
I will come back.
The national dialogue is about conceding that this country belongs to all of us. So there is nobody who is holy. There is nobody who is evil.
I want to hold you there. If you can hold there, Honorable Muchitali, I'll come back to you later. Moses, seems like this whole conversation is so much politicized that a country cannot talk about anything else other than talking about the person of the president and the politics of this country.
You are talking about the economy. You are talking about the institutions. But I can definitely tell you, we have malnourished institutions. They are stunted institutions. They have been captured by one man, just by order, you do something. You have seen, let me quote the Minister of Finance. I think on several occasions, on two terms, Mr. Kasaija has gone ahead to sign some agreements, and thereafter he comes and said, I didn't know. Like the Chinese, whatever, the one of the airport. Who do you think negotiated that? I was on this show, and we discussed that issue entirely, and we realized it was that man you're talking about, the Ayatollah of Uganda. He has captured everything. Yes, no problem. But you know the process under which he's elected. It has always been contested. You remember even they went to court.
But even,
and
the court said, even the ones of Kenyans have been contested
yes,
before.
But so, I mean I remember the one of Kizza Besigye when he went to court, and you remember what the court pronounced, how the court pronounced itself.
Mm.
That there was rigging, but that rigging wasn't too much to cause a rerun. You remember? So now we can't bring such issues. That's why we even advocated for electoral reforms. Now, when I tell you, when we talk about, we discuss economic issues, and all the institutions of Uganda are not independent, they cannot function independently. Now, why do you tell me we can have a dialogue without him? There is no way. Look at what his son is doing vis-a-vis other soldiers' conduct. The son does something contrary, he just comes and says, please, we are sorry.
Mm.
What if it was another person? Would it be the same? The kind of impunity. Now, but there is no way, and let me tell you, politics, actually I can say politics rules all the spheres in the developing countries. Everything, including the governorship, including the Bank of Uganda we are talking about. It is politics. Not, but in other developed countries, these institutions work independently, and they have their own powers. Unlike here in Uganda particularly. They are not independent at all. So there is no way we are going to dialogue maybe the judiciary, you discuss judiciary, blah, 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 you discuss the economy. If the man is going to order, you man.
Can you tell me where the COVID-19 money went? I will come back to you. I think it's an issue about this dialogue,
about Museveni. Let me say this.
Mm.
We cannot have a dialogue in Uganda, I agree,
without
President Museveni.
Mm.
But we don't have to have a dialogue about him only.
No, okay. It's not
about him. There's
actually,
a difference.
This is what politicians want to reduce it to.
It's part of the debate.
Mm.
I am saying we can have a dialogue. It would be a wishful thinking, as Honorable Mkhitaryan said, to have a dialogue about the future of this country when the chief executive is not involved. He has to be involved. But what I am finding a difficulty about is for people to think we should be so obsessed about discussing him alone.
Yes, the personality
a big,
and his
exactly.
family, certainly.
Uganda is much bigger. Uganda has got a history. Uganda has got a present. Uganda has got a future we are aspiring to.
Mm.
We want to have a conversation, looking back from where we have come from, noting the challenges that we have today, looking at the future we want to go to. How can we together shape that Uganda that we want with his involvement? But if we get obsessed too much about the personality, we are losing the plot, because one day there will be a Uganda without Museveni.
But
like one day there will be a Uganda without all of us.
Unless we are saying
Moses,
we have a dialogue
like,
after him.
It looks like
that's what they fail.
Moses, if I can just actually guide here, seems like most of our politicians seems to be highly entitled that they should be the one to front this whole conversation of national dialogue. Why not for once leave other people from different, professions and different areas in our country and sectors to lead this whole conversation? Because they also have a much bigger stake than what you have as politicians.
Now, let me ask, have you had any businessman coming up agitating for a dialogue? Just give me one.
Because you have
no,
occupied all
no,
this.
No, don't tell me when I say, when I talk of a dialogue, then I'm deterring him from talking about it. Just tell me one businessman who has come up and said, please, we need to dialogue.
Mm.
The church, the YCRC has tried, but you see the movement. It has been some old story.
But it's a process, actually.
Yes.
You don't expect
which
it to
now,
be an event.
Now, I said, unless we talk about a dialogue after myself. If you're talking about a dialogue, when he's still in power.
Then you are actually going back to what Frank has been saying, that you are reducing this whole national conversation
I told you, he has, I don't know how I can even term it, he got all the powers from, I don't know, he's everything in simple terms. In some cases, I call him Mr. Institution. Mr. Institution. For me, I call him Mr. Institution. Every single institution, go to the religious institutions. Under him.
Religious institutions?
Yes! Under him, no. This is not a joke.
You are really going.
It's not a joke.
I mean, The religious institutions have their own structures. Please. But anyway,
if you have been living in Uganda, I understand you know what I'm talking about. If you have been in Uganda for some time,
I'll come back to you, Moses. Let me bring in Frank before I go back.
But you didn't tell me any business person who agitated for Federal.
I will, and this is what actually I want Frank to actually highlight here. We've been having people, politicians, political parties, trying to own this whole process, and they want to be in the driving seat of this whole process. Is this not just entitlement, and we are losing the point?
Without, I recognize the important role of political parties as aggregators of societal opinion in terms of the pursuit of power. But at the same time, I don't think that political parties alone are the custodians of society's aspirations. The business community is interested in a stable country. We have seen dialogues of the business community of Kasita and government focusing on just business. But I think everybody is interested in peace. Everybody is interested in a shared prosperity. Everybody is interested in equity, in hospitals that work, in a country that works for all. Now, the emphasis of a national dialogue, how it is opposed to a bilateral negotiation between political parties and deals being cut between various political leaders.
A dialogue
means that we are trying to ask ourselves, can we press the button called reset? What Honorable McTell is saying, that we have had very many issues that are simmering at the same time, we may need to have a conversation to press the reset button.
Yes.
That reset button cannot be pressed by only politicians. We need to religious leaders in the room, we need cultural leaders in the room, we need traditional leaders in the room, we need farmers, we need teachers, we need everybody, we need academicians, we need media, everybody. Because we are talking about the Uganda that we want. What I want to hear from the politicians and everybody else is to talk about the structuring of such a conversation. What I'm hearing is people fear that conversation to be hijacked. Yes. When they hear Mao talking about it, they think it is because of his deal with Museveni. When they hear religious leaders talk about it, they say it is because somebody has been pocketed. Now, Matovu is telling you that he's calling Mr. Museveni Mr. Institution, meaning that any institution that comes up with you say, you're in Museveni's pocket.
No,
so there's a lack of trust to begin with. And I am asking Ugandans that there will be a country after all of us have gone. We need to ask ourselves, can we think about Uganda and first remove it from personalities? Because as long as we think about personalities, we shall get lost in the forest.
Absolutely.
We need to ask ourselves, if we want a Uganda that works for our children in 2055, what should we do today? And we sit in the room and talk about it. Because one day, that day is going to come. If we keep postponing it because there's a big man in State House, when will we talk?
Exactly. And let's talk about actually this whole conversation. Honorable Muchitali, if you are still online, I just want to pick your view on who exactly should lead this conversation. And why should politicians really want to own this as if it is just a matter of politics and other issues don't matter to this country?
National dialogue is about owning our status quo. Stop denial. When we had HIV, we agreed that when you accept there is a problem, you can deal with it and do positive living. So we know the interreligious council, the eminent women, the cultural institutions, Justice Ogola, my professor Letin Sivan, they have been at this subject matter of national dialogue for long without it taking course. It is also true, when I was still a young man working regularly in Kenya, it is the lawyers, it is the bishops, which pushed President Moi into some reforms. I am saying, the President Museveni, being the fountain owner, when he appoints Norbert Mao as Minister of Constitutional Affairs, that's a lot of leverage and latitude, if well used. So don't wish off President Museveni. I am not for iPod exclusive dialogue. I am for a comprehensive national dialogue. I am talking about the economy being in foreign hands. I am talking about an education system which has produced jobless graduates, which needs reforms. I am talking about radicalized children. 50 60 years of independence, 37 of them NRM, radicalized children. You've seen what's happening, extremism, fanatism, you know, fundamentalism, meaning that any time this country, we can go into a problem, God forbid, if we don't have a proactive, preventive dialogue now. And that's why it is important that we agree. It's not going to be my NRM alone because we are in power. It's not going to be the political parties which are dead anyway. In political science, I can tell you, all parties are dead if I use my analysis as a political scientist. But also remember, political parties are institutions, the only institution which aligns to seek for power with ideological clarity, with interest aggregation, with cadre mentoring. Even when people say we are now getting. So I have to say, before we jump there into just electioneering, democracy is not about electioneering. Democracy and governance has a sense of belonging, has a tolerance and coexistence, has issues of equity and equitability. You know, it is much, not just electioneering and having an election. That's called electioneering. That's not democracy. So what we need today, for those who will don't even intend to stand one day, but they're in private sector, and the taxpayers funding my NRM government, when can we listen to them when they are choking post-COVID, but they don't seem to be getting incentives and stimulus to sustain the economy?
Honorable,
when our children are taking themselves as slaves in the Arab world for jobs, and we don't have jobs here. These are issues. You don't even have to be NRM like me to say, because I'm NRM, I must be seen to be clean. The country has issues which need to be addressed today. And that's why we need.
We have to wind up this conversation.
Come again.
We have to wind up this whole conversation.
I'm missing you there.
We have to wind up this whole conversation because we are running out of time. But one question before, and I want to put it to all of you in 1 minute.
Mm.
Should a national dialogue be a progressive and also a continuous process, or it has a limit and we should reach a point and say, now there is no more need for having a national dialogue, or it is a continuous process?
I want to say, ideally, if all was fine, Parliament itself is a dialogue, but Parliament as it is today has become a monologue. It is a one side, it is tyranny of numbers of my NRM majority.
It has become monologue after your
Parliament
arrest,
has
right?
become an extension. Parliament has become an extension of an executive. We are looking forward to a time when we look at extra-politician dialogue. We look at issues of values and essence of this country, the education system, the economy, reducing the powers of the president, having a strong mandate of parliament, empowering regional governments, having the budget going to away from the center to the community, and consensus. Even if you want to have development, but the country is going to be, we have lost 48 years of independence fighting ourselves.
Thank you so much, Honorable Pichitare. I have to cut you. I have to stop you. Thank you so much, Honorable Pichitare, for joining us this morning. And Frank, I want actually to finalize this conversation. Should there be a limit?
Yeah.
Or are we looking at having a conversation and a process that should have a limit?
Okay. The organization that I work for, the Netherlands Institute for Multipartite Democracy, has got an adage which says that democracy starts with the dialogue.
Mm.
In any society, there should always be a space for continuous engagement.
Mm.
I don't believe that there should be a time of saying now dialogue should end. There should be a space for continuous engagement with stakeholders at all times. However, dialogue sessions should come to an end. There should be an agenda that we discuss and agree upon, implement what we have agreed upon. When the need comes to discuss other issues, bring them again. But we should be willing to look at each other respectfully, to talk about the things that matter. I want to end by saying, time has come for our politicians and other people in our country to stop looking at competing ideas as if it is enmity.
Yes.
These are just competing ideas. We're just opponents. We're just disagreed on the way forward. But we're not enemies. and we are all contributors to the project called A Better Uganda. Absolutely. If we change that attitude, we'll stand a good chance to improve our country.
Thank you. Moses, your parting shot.
About that question, I think we need to structure. There are some pertinent issues that should be addressed as of now. Then other issues can come later.
Mm.
But now, in a situation where you are, where people are agitating for a dialogue and you have panda guard. Now, you lose a point whether you're going to discuss the sharing of resources vis-a-vis people picked in drones, arbitrary arrests, torture, etc. So that is where the problem is, that we should have an agenda, but as we set that agenda, let us not behave like somebody who was in Nairobi. They are discussing of how to bring peace and the other side is fighting. We should avoid such a scenario. If you are going to discuss, let us at least have that goodwill. This country belongs to us all. We are all Ugandans. Actually, so many leaders have come, they have gone, Uganda has remained. So and we should know Uganda is for us all, and it should work for us all, not for a certain section of people.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. We've been discussing national dialogue and when, who, and what issues should be discussed in that conversation. With me has been Frank Rusa, the Executive Secretary for IPOD, Honorable Stephen Muchitale, former Member of Parliament for Bolisa County, and Mr. Matovu Moses, the spokesperson for the National Economic Empowerment Dialogue. My name is Mubarak Mugabo. We are taking a short break. We are coming back with a Rush Talk.
Tosubwaga fa kubye mizanyo. Neba nabya mizanyo abachasinze wanoni.